Hello, everyone. I'm happy to greet today Dr. Francesco Gervaso, who will be our today's speaker within the Flamingo webinars. Let me say a few words about Francesca. Dr. Francesca Gervaso is a researcher at the Institute of Nanotechnology of National Research Council. She has a PhD in bioengineering and master degree in mechanical engineering. Her main interest focuses on the design and development of biomaterials for tissue engineering and biomechanics. At the moment, she works with a multidisciplinary team on the development of 3D in vitro models, including organ-on-chip solutions, as potential drug testing tools, supervising the research activity on cell-laden hydrogel development. I'm very curious about this topic, and I guess also our other participants. So, Francesca, most welcome. Thank you very much for coming, and the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, Sasha, for your kind introduction. Today, I would like to show with my talk how is it possible to rebuild biological tissue by means of a tissue engineering approach. It's not going, no? Okay. But before to start with the topic of my talk, I would like just to very briefly say some words about the Flamingo project. The Flamingo project has been founded by the European community and is within this project that has been organized the webinar of today. And the focus of this project is to address a very important clinical problem. That is rheumatoid arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis is an autoimmune inflammatory disorder that is primarily characterized by the synovial joint inflammation. Unfortunately, no cures are available currently. However, several drugs are available that can attenuate or even eliminate the symptoms. However, the choice of the drug has been performed on based on a trial and error practice more than a very rational. So the rheumatology community has a very strict need for developing alternative strategies to deliver innovative trials in order to identify the best therapy for each patient. So the Flamingo mission is to develop a personalized the next generation synovium chip that can be a very physiologically relevant model of the rheumatoid arthritic joint that will hopefully allow patient-specific clinical trials on chip. This in the mission of Flamingo, so we want to select the best on market drug for each patient treatments and to obtain the maximum benefits, reducing the risk of side effects. In order, secondly, we want to enable a rapid discovery and testing new therapeutic targets in order to contribute to determine a new drug development path. I don't know why it's not working. So where do we want to arrive? The project has started since 1 year and a half and will last. I'm sorry for the background noise, but it's really strongly raining. I'm sorry. And so the project will end at the end of the 2024. And the aim of this project is to develop a synovium chip. This new kind of in vitro model will hopefully allow to give up the current predictive model that is not satisfactory, moving towards a new predictive model of drug response for a specific patient. But what is a synovium chip? So it is, what are organ-on-chip systems? The organ-on-chips are microfluidic platforms that allow to culture the cells in dynamic condition and that are used as a physiopathological models and tools to test drugs. So we can say that organ-on-chip systems are in vitro models that are physiologically representative of organ functions. So a few words just to say why we need to develop a new in vitro models, because the traditional in vitro models of tissues and organs are here reported in these slides, are cells on a petri dish and followed by animal models. But both of them have been, of course, fundamental in the drug discovery and in order to understand a lot of biological phenomena, but they have both strong limitations. The first one, the cells culture on a petri dish, do not take into account the three-dimensionality of the biological tissue that cannot be neglected. And the animal model's physiology is often very far from the human physiology. So in this context, in this project, we want to develop a very representative model of the rheumatoid arthritis synovia system. So we wanted to use the organ-on-chip approach, but also combined with a 3D model of the tissue. First of all, I want to highlight that the synovia system is very complex because it's not made of only one tissue. It is made up of several tissues, such as bone, cartilage, synovial fluid, synovia membrane, and also vessels. So in order to represent all these components, and also to take into account the three-dimensionality of the tissue, we want to use an organ-on-chip approach coupled with a tissue engineering approach. The aim of this project is very challenging, but a lot of partners are involved and are here represented. And we hope that with the cooperation of all these partners, we can reach our final goal. Now I will present you a very short video about my institutes. I'm a researcher of the CNR Nanotech. Nanotech is an institute of the CNR that is located in the south of Italy. So now I will show you what are the main research activity that are going on in our institute.
The Institute of Nanotechnology, Nanotech, is part of the National Research Council, CNR, the largest public research institution in Italy, founded in 1923, and having over 5,000 researchers active in 88 institutes. Nanotech's main location is nicely nestled in the vibrant university campus in Lecce, a young and dynamic environment, strongly devoted to basic and applied sciences. Nanotech Lecce is a multidisciplinary research center featuring more than 12,000 square meters of labs and clean rooms, and hosting over 200 researchers with interdisciplinary backgrounds spanning from physics to medicine, passing through chemistry, biology, and engineering. Our mission is the development and prototyping of innovative materials and devices using top-down and bottom-up approaches, with particular attention towards creation of startups and spin-offs, joint labs with international companies, and collaborations with venture capital funds. Nanotech research labs are organized in 6 open-access facilities, fully equipped for R&D in defined key enabling technologies. Thank you.
Okay, moving back to the Flamingo project, here I reported which are the activities, the research activities that are in charge of Nanotech. Nanotech is in charge with the design and the microfabrication of the organ-on-chip platforms, and also on the development of the microsensor to sense the important parameters of the microenvironment in which cells are embedded, such as pH or oxygen. Moreover, CNR Nanotech also leads the activity of exploitation of the Flamingo results. And the last but not least, we are in charge with the synthesis of the extracellular matrix analogs for the synovial unit. And is on this activity that today I want to give some more details in my talk. So why we want to rebuild the tissue? In order to synthesize extracellular matrix analogs and to have a very relevant model in vitro, we need to provide cells with the proper house. What does it mean? If we look at the images, histological images that are here reported, we can see that we have different cells that are embedded in very different structure and architecture. It means that it's in order to rebuild a tissue, we for sure need, first of all, the specific cell type, but it's not enough. We also need to provide the specific cells with specific cell with its own right environment. And today I would like to show how is it possible to design the right environment for each specific cell by the use of a tissue engineering approach. So the tissue engineering approach is based of engineering principles. An engineer, for example, a civil engineer, design products for human good, such as, for example, a bridge that help us, for example, to cross a river by using the existing knowledge. So the work of a tissue engineering is not so far from that one of every other engineer. The difference here is the product. In this case, the product of the tissue engineering is the biological tissue. I mean a biological structure made up of cells of the same type. So also the tissue engineer aim at designing products for human goods, but these products are biological tissue. So what is tissue engineering? Now we can give a sort of definition. Tissue engineering is the production of tissue, biological tissue, by growing cells in porous absorbable scaffolds that are also called the matrices. Now we also refer to tissue engineering when this sort of 3D structure with the cells is directly put inside the body. This approach is also referred as regenerative medicine. So the first goal that I here reported of the tissue engineering is to provide the methods for the replacement and the regeneration of damaged tissue. And now it's quite clear that is something like this. But I want also to highlight that the tissue engineering provide the methods also for creating tissue-like models for disease research. And this is close to the goal of our European project. Why the tissue engineering was born and why we did need different approaches to regenerate tissues. First of all, because most tissues cannot regenerate when they are injured or diseased. And even that tissue that has the spontaneous ability to regenerate, so that can spontaneously regenerate, may not completely do so if the defect or the portion of the tissue that they want to regenerate is very large. Moreover, the replacement of the tissue with permanent implants is still greatly limited. But very important is also that physiologically relevant models of biological tissue needed to study the physiopathology and also the drug response are still lacking, and we really need it. So now very quick, just a few words to say when the tissue engineering approach was born, and I just highlighted the selected milestone in the tissue engineering process. The first tissue engineering product for sure has been introduced in 1980 from Jannas. When Jannas used for the first time a matrix made of collagen and glycosaminoglycans for dermal regeneration, he didn't call it tissue engineering. He just introduced a new approach to treat the regeneration and the problem of lack of biological tissue. To arrive at the definition of a new field called tissue engineering, we have to wait till 1993, when Langer and Vacanti, they published a paper on the journal Science on the tissue engineering. And if we read the abstract of this pioneer paper, we can see that they say a new field, tissue engineering, applies the principle of biology and engineering to the development of functional substitute for damaged tissue. So here the very important things that I wanted to highlight and that since at the beginning, also the pioneers of this approach, they knew that an interdisciplinary team is necessary in order to produce very functional tissue in vitro. So we need to know the principle of biology, of material science, engineering, and only using all these principles together, we can arrive to provide a solution to the tissue creation in laboratory. So, what we need to make a tissue engineering substitute or construct? We need of mainly three components that are scaffold, cells, and regulators. These three main actors are fundamental in order to provide a tissue engineering construct. So the scaffold is a structure, as a three-dimensional structure that has to be porous and absorbable. And of course, has to be made of biomaterial, I mean a material that is biocompatible. The scaffold has to be porous because it has to allow cells to penetrate inside the structure and to colonize the entire structure, and absorbable because in the principle of tissue engineering, the cells inside the scaffold has to build the new tissue by themselves. In the meantime, the scaffolds has to degrade slowly with hopefully the same rate of the absorption of the tissue regeneration. So we can say that the scaffold can serve to regulate the cell function prior to its absorption. Of course, we need cells. Cells in the tissue engineering can be from different sources. They can be autologous or allogenic. We can use differentiated cells of the same tissue type that we want to regenerate, but also stem cells that can be differentiated by several stimuli, and also other type of cells. Finally, we have regulators. What are regulators? Regulators can be chemical or physical cues that provide to the system scaffold and cells will induce some cell process within the scaffolds. So for example, we can improve the differentiation of cells into a precise phenotype that we want, or also to increase the synthesis of extracellular matrix by cells. Although cells are fundamental in order to build a tissue in a laboratory, some evidence from literature highlighted that without a scaffold, cells alone are not enough. So I wanted to point my attention on the scaffold structure and which are the materials that we can use to produce a scaffold. The first of all are polymers, because the extracellular matrix is made of protein that can be in a certain manner called the polymers as well. So they resemble they mimic very closely the extracellular matrix of the biological tissues. So we have both synthetic polymers such as polylactic and polyglycolic acid, just to say one or two, but there are many others that can be successfully used. But also natural polymers such as fibrin, collagen, and also composite of them, but also alginate from algae and chitosan from shrimp and so on. If the natural polymers are for sure the best option for most of the biological tissue regeneration for the bone that has a very strong inorganic component, like a mineral component, the choice can fall into the bioceramics, like calcium phosphate and hydroxyapatite, that is can be prepared in laboratory, but very close to the natural one. Now I want to highlight that the scaffold properties are fundamental in order to induce cells to make some function or to rebuild the tissue that we want to rebuild. The most important properties, physical properties, is the porosity. Our structure needs to be porous in order to be colonized by cells. But also the chemical properties are very important, because they affect the biodegradation, the biodegradability, so the resorbable rate of the scaffold. And then the chemical properties are responsible of the cell attachment, the chemical composition will affect the cell attachment to the scaffold surface. And also they affect also other cell functions, such as mitosis and biosynthesis of extracellular matrix. But even the mechanical properties are fundamental, because cells are really influenced by the mechanical cue that they can feel in the microenvironment. Is there a field that is called mechanobiology that study the importance of the mechanical stimuli that act on the cell behavior? So the strength and also the stiffness of our scaffolds is very fundamental in order to provide the right house for ourselves. Now, only a few examples just to show the cell scaffold interaction and how the properties of the scaffolds can indeed influence cell function. For example, in this video, I can show you that some a fibroblast that has been plated on a stiff side of a polymer is migrating, and he start to migrate when he reach the soft side of the substrate that has been marked with the fluorescent beads to be recognized. The cells change its direction, because the cells doesn't like the soft side and prefer to stay in the stiff side. So we can see that in this way, we influenced the cell behavior migration, the cell function migration with a properties of the scaffold. So the a mechanical properties, the stiffness of the substrate. And here is the opposite behavior. So if the cells is plated in the soft side, the cells start to migrate. And when it reaches the stiff side, doesn't change its direction anymore, but goes on in the stiff side. So it's just an example to see how powerful are the properties of a scaffold as influencing the cell behavior. So summarizing what I said about the tissue engineering, we can say that the principle on which the tissue engineering is based is that scaffolds, porous, absorbable, three-dimensional structure can regulate cell function by both their chemical makeup and by their structure and architecture. So the practice of tissue engineering is just to apply methods for producing scaffolds with the selected chemical composition and structure in order to obtain a regenerated tissue in vitro. So here I want to coming back to the rebuilding tissue. And now that we know what tissue engineering is, and now we know that each cells need a specific environment, I reported an image from a very recent paper on tissue engineering in which is highlighted that in order to regenerate muscle, peripheral nerve or vascular system or bone tissue, we cannot use the same structure and even the same materials. For each tissue that we want to regenerate, we need a specific material and with a specific architecture and three-dimensional organization. So here I reported a sort of vademecum of the tissue engineering. So how, if I want to regenerate a tissue in a lab, how can I proceed? First of all, I need to know very well the tissue that I want to rebuild. So the components, its architecture, the mechanical properties, and so on. Then I have to select the scaffold material. And in order to select the scaffold material, I have already know which degradation rate I want and also which kind of stiffness mechanical properties I'm interested in. And according to the selected material, I then have to select the best technology that will allow me to fabricate the three-dimensional structure with that geometry, architecture, porosity, and with that material that I selected before. Then of course, I need to characterize my scaffold, first of all, in terms of physico-chemical properties, because I have to check if the requirements that I had in terms of porosity, stiffness, they were reached. So when I'm sure that the scaffolds I wanted to build as to fabricate has been fabricated, then I can start to test the biological properties. So in this case, I need to select the cells to be used, and finally to test if we really provide the cells with its specific house. I mean, if the in vitro tissue that I formed is functional. Now I will give you an example of this approach. So just reporting some results of the research of the past year that I performed with colleagues of mine on, for example, cartilage regeneration. So in order to regenerate the cartilage, as I showed you before in the vademecum, the first thing that I have is to know the tissue that I want to rebuild. So I have to search all the information about the anatomy, physiology, composition of articular cartilage. And the cartilage, I can see that is composed primarily by water, that is a very high content, around 70-85%, collagen type 1, that is around 10-20%, and proteoglycans. So the second step of the process of building a tissue in a laboratory is to select the scaffold material. So here, if I remember, that the articular cartilage is mainly made of collagen, the first choice in order to prepare the right environment is to choose collagen. So we decide to use collagen to make our scaffold. Then in order to select the fabrication technique, we also consider that since the water content is very high, around 85%, it means that the porosity as the ratio between the void and the solid is very high. So we choose the freeze drying technique, that is a technique that allow to obtain very highly and highly interconnected porous structure. So at the end, we need to characterize the fabricated scaffold. Here I reported some results of some paper of us, in which the first thing that we wanted to check was, of course, the morphology of the structure. So the first thing that we need to verify is if the porosity we could obtain a good porosity, an interconnected porosity. So some scanning electron microscope analysis has been performed. Then other tests, several tests can be done to characterize from a physico-chemical point of view. So here we evaluated the ability to swell of the samples and to retain water, that is a very important properties of the biological tissue, and also the degradation rate in terms of loss of weight percentage. Then once we developed the right scaffold with the right physico-chemical properties, we started to test with cells. So the first biological test is to check the viability of cells in our 3D structure. So we can perform, for example, a live dead assay that will show the numbers of by immunofluorescence analysis, the numbers of cells that are alive and of dead cells. In this case, all the cells were alive because they are green. So if some dead cells would be present, it would be a red dot. Then, in order to check the functionality of the tissue, we need to perform a more deeper biological characterization, for example, to check some immunohistochemistry by evaluating the main components of the physiological natural articular cartilage, such as collagen type 2, aggrecan, and SOX9. Finally, we also want to check the mechanical properties of the tissue constructs after that cells have been built inside the structure and have synthesized the matrix inside. So we performed some mechanical tests in order to check the increase in the mechanical stiffness according to the production of extracellular matrix by cells. So very quick, another example, just to see, just to show what I meant with the proper house for each cells. For example, now we want to rebuild the bone. The bone has a very different composition with respect to the cartilage, because here we have an organic matrix that is the 22%, but we have mostly inorganic matrix, around 70% in weight. And then we have water, but in a very less content that in articular cartilage. So in this case, we could not choose the same material and the same technology that we use for cartilage. And in this case, so we selected the hydroxyapatite, we developed different kind of hydroxyapatite in order to mimic more closely, as closest as possible, the natural hydroxyapatite of human bone. Then also, in order to fabricate this scaffold that is with a ceramic material, we needed to choose another fabrication technique that should allow to obtain a solid structure in a ceramic material. So we choose the sponge replica method that consists of infiltrate a sponge, a polyurethane sponge with that is the template of our scaffold with a ceramic suspension. Then the sponges are squeezed and then sintered. At the end, we can see that we can obtain a structure that is very close to the bone structure. Even here, we then characterized the scaffold that we obtained before in terms of physicochemical properties, just to check the hydroxyapatite content and the composition, and then again the weight loss in time. And at the end, we also performed the cell test to check if the scaffold that we produce were biocompatible. But coming to the Flamingo project, and I will provide the last results of in this according to this talk, according to the rebuilding tissue, and in particular to rebuilding the synovial tissue. So first of all, we have to know the tissue that we want to rebuild. So again, we search for all the information about the composition of the synovial membrane. And we can see that the synovial is consists predominantly of fibroblast-like synoviocytes that form a layer that aligns the synovial membrane against the joint cavity and the synovial fluid. In addition, other than fibroblast-like synoviocytes, there are also macrophages that in this tissue are few in numbers. So in order to select the right materials, we in this case had to consider that the hydrogel and the structure, the tissue that we want to rebuild, will need to be inserted into an organ on chip, as I show at the beginning of my talk. So in this case, we decide to use not a preformed 3D structure as a scaffold, but to use an hydrogel. And in order to form the hydrogel, we use a stimuli responsiveness. It means that we can embed the cells directly into the polymeric solution, and then applying a stimulus from outside, for example, the temperature or UV radiation, we can cross-link the polymeric solution and obtain a gel. So we can induce the sol-gel transition by applying different stimuli. So we used both the temperature and the photosensitive and the thermosensitive, and in this case we used a chitosan-based material, and the photosensitive hydrogel that is a gelatin-based. Here in the picture, you can see some example of on my left of a thermosensitive material that can easily flow in the vial when we are at room temperature, and that becomes an hydrogel and cannot flow anymore when we increase the temperature at a physiological value of 37 degrees. So compatible with the cells that we want to insert inside. On the right, we have a photosensitive gelatin-based hydrogels that is can flow, that is a sort of liquid at room temperature and without any radiation. And here we can see the hydrogel after UV irradiation. So we started to characterize this fabricated scaffold. So we analyzed the structure, the morphology of the hydrogels by using the scanning electron microscope. And we checked that the porosity was something that responded to our target. So very high porosity and also interconnected. Then we evaluated the weight loss in time of the structure according to different composition of material. And also we evaluated the ability of swell of these samples and also the mechanical properties of this structure. And also for this, we made it for both this characterization for the thermosensitive hydrogels and also for the gelatin metacrylate, the gelatin-based hydrogel. Then we moved, we were quite happy about the results, the physicochemical results that we obtained. And so we moved to the biological test. So now the first set of experiments that we performed were planned using the normal healthy fibroblast-like synoviocytes, human fibroblast-like synoviocytes, and this cell population have been encapsulated into, so embedded within the two injectable hydrogel, both the thermosensitive and the photoresponsive. So the first set of biological experiment aimed at evaluating the viability, and both the hydrogels shown to be very high biocompatibility up to 7 days of culture. Then in order to understand if the hydrogel system that we developed for this specific cell line, we needed to check the cell morphology. The cell morphology was evaluated by immunofluorescence. The cell were stained for DAPI and phalloidin to check both the nuclei location and also the shape of the cells and the cytoskeleton shape. As we can see in the picture here reported, after 7 days but also after 21 days, the fibroblast-like synoviocyte embedded in the chitosan hydrogel did not show the physiological elongated spindle-like shape of the fibroblast-like synoviocytes. However, in the GELMA, the morphology was for sure better, and the cells started to show an elongate shape and to assume the more the physiological morphology of the fibroblast-like synoviocyte of a human in a natural tissue. However, these tests have not been completed yet. Now, from these two hydrogel, we can say that GELMA is the best performing, but we need to check other functionality of this tissue that we build in vitro. So we need to check if the cells produce extracellular matrix as the fibroblast synovocyte do in vivo, and also if they secern cytokines. And then the following step will be to evaluate all these conditions in the rheumatoid arthritis population. So I finished my presentation. I hope that I was able to give you an insight about what rebuilding a tissue in laboratory means, and also to show you what we are doing in the Flamingo project according to these topics that I showed you. First of all, I want to thank all the people that works with me in laboratory. First of all, Alessandro Polini, that worked with me in the Flamingo project, but also Giuseppe Gigli, that is the director of my institute, and all the other people that every day go in laboratory to make all the results possible. Thank you very much.